Good morning. Welcome to Elmer Christian Reformed Church. It's good to have you here in the building. It's good to have you online, wherever you are worshiping. It is an important thing to do on a Sunday morning to gather together. We also can gather together on the front lawn after the service to have some coffee and juice and tea usually out there. Everyone is welcome. And this is your opportunity to talk to somebody who you might not normally connect with. So take advantage of that and say hi around the coffee table. We welcome Mr. Richard Pratinga to the pulpit today. We wish you God's blessing as you lead us in worship today.
Let us pray. O Lord God Almighty, we creatures of your design, we come to you in worship and adoration. We ask that you accept the praise of our lips and the devotion of our hearts, because we come to you in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us rise to receive the Lord's greeting. God greets us with these ancient words that he gave his servant Moses to greet his people whom he was leading out of bondage in Egypt. And they apply to us too, whom he is leading into the joy and freedom of the promised land, his eternal promised land. Blessed are you, a people saved by the Lord, the eternal one is your refuge, and underneath are his everlasting arms. Amen. Let us praise this God who saves us, shelters us, and sustains us with the words and music of 237. We praise you, O God. Let us go to the Lord in a time of confession. Lord of the ages, so often we live as though we are forever, and you are but a passing vapor which hardly merits our consideration. Lord, forgive us for not loving you with our whole hearts and minds, or our neighbors as ourselves. By your Holy Spirit, Lord, lead us onward and move us to truly be the love song that blesses your name by our living in gratitude for your forgiving love through the work of Jesus our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Assurance of pardon comes to us in these words from Jesus: ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened unto you. For anyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Amen. God's will for his forgiven people is that they do unto others as they would want others to do to them. This sums up the law and the prophets according to Matthew 7, verse 12. At this time, Leslie Vandenbrink is going to bring the children's message.
Bushes. I have bushes and a little bit of flowers around my house. But then right by my deck in the backyard, we have these boxes, and in them we grow wildflowers, and it's supposed to attract butterflies. None of the plants will. And we are kind of like sunflowers, because we also need a sun to grow, not an S-U-N, an S-O-N. What kind of sun do you think I might mean, Amelia? Jesus, right? If we, like the sunflower, are always turning ourselves towards Jesus, then we're going to grow up good and strong and comforted the way we're supposed to. if we turn ourselves away from the sun, like the sunflower here who doesn't have very much sun, we're not going to grow as tall and as strong and as good as we can. So it's important for us to keep ourselves towards the sun. I'm losing my petals, I know. It's been out of the water for a little while. So my petals are falling. That's okay. There we go. I'll pick it up. So we want to be just like the sunflower and try and turn ourselves to Jesus, the sun. Where can we find Jesus? How can we learn about him? Does anybody know? By praying. That's a good way. Where can we read about Jesus? In the Bible. Some of you are going to go to Sunday school. Do you learn about Jesus when you go to Sunday school? Yeah. Do you learn about Jesus from your mom and dads? Or your grandmas and your grandpas? From your friends? Maybe from your teachers? These are all great sources for us to get the sun, the S-O-N instead of the S-U-N. All right, let's pray. Dear Jesus, we want to follow you. Help us listen to God's word and put it into practice in our daily life. In your name we pray. Amen. So if you are 3, 4, and 5, you're going to go to Sunday school, and the rest of you are going to go back with your families, and we're going to sing, "Oh God, You Are My God." Are you 4? So you get to go to Sunday school. Come on, you're 5, you get to go to Sunday school. She gets to come too. That's awesome.
1 Corinthians 15:1, there was a note about Louise Weavering's sister, Nellie, who was in a hospital, and she continues to be in Victoria Hospital in critical condition. So we'll remember her and Hank and Luce in our prayers today, and please also remember them in your home, in your prayers at home this week. Let's pray. It's a privilege to come to church this morning. It's a blessing to come to you, Lord, with our prayers. You are so powerful and you are so big. In comparison, we are so helpless and small. But you want to hear from us, and we are humbled and thankful. Thank you for being in charge. We like to think that we choose how to live, but you hold our lives in your hands. You give us life. You give us breath. When we hurt, you comfort us. When we celebrate, you celebrate with us. Thank you for your love and constant presence in our lives. Help us to use the gifts and the blessings you have given to us, time, talents, treasures, creation. Help us to be productive with our time, to see how we can use it to serve you and others. Open our eyes to see the needs around us, and to make connections. A small act of kindness can have a big impact. Help us to take time for each other, especially in devotions and prayer, individually as well as as a family in order to keep our homes focused on you. Help us to use our time in a good balance between work and leisure. Each of us has been gifted also in unique ways. Help us to be aware of our gifts and put them to good use. We pray for people in leadership positions. May they make wise decisions as they guide countries, provinces, towns, businesses, churches. May each decision be made prayerfully as it impacts the lives of those in that area. Be with those who work behind the scenes. They may not get a lot of glory or notice, but their contributions are essential to making things run smoothly. Help them be encouraged to continue to work in your service. The Bible tells us to build up treasures in heaven rather than on earth. Show us how to use our financial resources wisely. Jobs and bank accounts are from you. Help us when we acknowledge that, giving back to you is a joy. Help us to be generous, especially supporting causes focused on your kingdom. We have often taken your creation for granted. We take and use, but we also need to protect it. All around the world, we are seeing extremes, high heats, torrential downpours and droughts, forest fires, and lush green crops. Help us to be responsible in our actions as they impact generations to come. Bring healing to our world where it is needed. Thank you for our church family. We celebrate with those who are celebrating birthdays this week. Crystal, Shirley, Jason, Janina, Thea, Elena, Graham, and Teresa. Thank you for the past years you have given them. Bless them in the coming year with all that you have in store for them. Equip them in their service to you, however that might be. Be with those who need you in a special way. Alice Kuipers, as she recovers from hip replacement surgery and adjusts to a new home. The Kroondike family with the recent passing of sister-in-law and aunt. John and Janet Miedemann family as John continues with cancer treatments. Reverend Norman Joan and Tina as Reverend Jones is waiting placement in long-term care. Nellie, the sister of Louise Weavering, we pray for healing for her body and surround her family with your loving care. Be with those who are not named, but in our hearts or minds with unstated issues. You know us, Lord. Be with each person and those who support them. We lay our concerns before you. Plans are underway for the coming ministry season. Thank you that Gordon Matthew could attend the Cadet Camperee this past week. Be with leaders making plans for the boys and cadets this year. Be with GEMS, nudge potential counselors to step up to join that ministry, guiding girls to learn more about you. Thank you for those working with our teens. As they closed out one season and make plans for the next, may they be encouraged by the impact they are having in our youth. Be with those who went on serve. May they continue to serve and learn more about you. Bless the work of the South Coast Beach Project, recipient of our offering this morning. Be with these young adults as they are working together in Port Dover as they spend the summer delving into themes of kingdom living and engaging with the local community. May they learn how to integrate faith and life in meaningful ways. Bless the get-togethers on our church's front lawn on Fridays. May we make meaningful connections with our church neighbors and with each other. Help us show that this is a loving church open to all, wanting to share your good news of salvation. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Accept also the offerings we now give. May they be a blessing to those who receive as well as to those who give. Amen. Your offerings this morning are dedicated to the budget as well as to South Coast Beach Project. If you're not sure what that is, take a look online. There's some interesting work that's being done there. Our deacons will now come forward.
Thank you, Megan, for that lovely number. As we turn to the word of the Lord, let's ask him to bless our hearts and minds and open them to what he has to say to us. Father in heaven, the words that we read in your scriptures are just mere words unless you open our hearts and minds by your Spirit so that we may be infused with what you would have us take away from the message that has been prepared. In Jesus' name we pray for that. Amen. And as we turn to Luke, chapters 17 and 18, I want to say that when I read these passages, it dawns on me every time again that you could have a whole series of sermons on these passages going for several months, because there is so much in there that one wonders about and that one can reflect upon. And my message that I prepared this morning digs into that just a little bit, because the Spirit led me to do so, but you will realize that much more could be said on these passages. So let us together read Luke chapter 17, beginning at the reading at verse 20. Once on being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, Jesus replied, "The coming of the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed. Nor will people say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God is in your midst. Then he said to his disciples, the time is coming when you will long to see one of the days of the Son of Man, but you will not see it. People will tell you, there he is or here he is. Do not go running off after them, for the Son of Man in his day will be like the lightning which flashes and lights up the sky from one end to the other. But first, he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation. Just as it was in the days of Noah, so also will it be in the days of the Son of Man. People were eating, drinking, and marrying, and being given in marriage up to the day that Noah entered the ark. Then the flood came and destroyed them all. It was the same in the days of Lot. People were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. But the day Lot left Sodom and destroyed them all. It will be just like this on the day of the day that the Son of Man is revealed. On that day, no one who is on the housetop with possessions inside should go down to get them. Likewise, no one in the field should go back for anything. Remember Lot's wife. Whoever tries to keep their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life will preserve it. I tell you, on that night, two people will be in one bed, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding grain together, one will be taken and the other left. Where, Lord? They asked. He replied, where there is a dead body, there the vultures will gather. Going on to chapter 18, then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, in a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, grant me justice against my adversary. For some time he refused. But finally he said to himself, even though I don't fear God or care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually come and attack me. And the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry to him, who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Thus far, the reading of God's word this morning, may he bless our meditation upon it. And I have sent something that the projectionists can put on at the beginning of the message, and then they can drop it after I'm on to about my third page. Dear people of God, have you ever heard of Alice Bailey? No, she's not the originator of that delightful Irish liqueur by the same name. Alice Bailey, well, you may not have heard of her, but nevertheless, she has had a very negative influence on your life and on the structure and viewpoint of Western society. More of an influence than you would ever think possible for someone who lived way back between 1880 and 1949. Alice Bailey, you see, is the mother of the New Age movement. Now, you may think that the New Age movement, well, that's something we heard about in the 80s and the 90s, but in the last few decades, not so much. True enough, And that's just how Alice Bailey would have liked to have it. According to Wikipedia, New Age is a cultic milieu which became conscious of itself in the late 1970s. That is, it became conscious of itself as a somewhat unified movement. All forms of this movement are critical of Western culture in terms of a secularized terminology. In simpler words, New Agers are secular in outlook and use words that they understand best themselves to criticize what is good in our culture. It's no wonder that New Age undermines our values because Alice Bailey purposely set out to make New Age the dominant religion and lifestyle of the world. To that end, other religions, especially Christianity, would have to become less of an influence on society and on individual lives. It is from this desire to see the dominance of the New Age movement that she wrote the following 10 points to destroy Christianity. 1, take God and prayer out of the educational system. 2, reduce parental authority over their children. 3, destroy the traditional Judeo-Christian family structure. 4, promote free sex and make abortion legal and easy. 5, free people from that concept of marriage for life. Rather, make divorce legal and easy. 6, make homosexuality an alternative lifestyle. 7, debase art. Make it run wild and mad. 8, use media to promote and change people's mindsets. 9, create an interfaith movement, a movement of different religions getting together. And 10, get government to accept these ideas and make them law, and get churches to endorse the changes as well. Judge for yourself, friends. Aren't today's trends in family, in education, in religion, and in culture and social outlook just what those 10 points sought to accomplish? One of the devilishly clever aspects of the New Age movement is source amnesia. Source amnesia is the fact that people have no idea where their ideas and values come from. And they don't really care to look it up either. So we're not surprised at the sneaky, yeast-like spread of her movement when we learn that Alice Bailey said that the majority of her work was telepathically dictated to her by a master of wisdom spirit named Jawal Kool. There we have it up on the screen. Jawal Kool spoke these 10 ideas to her mind. Truly, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms, says Apostle Paul in Ephesians 6, verse 12. Now, of course, Jesus was very much aware of these evil powers and forces, and therefore he urges us to pray tirelessly, or there is the real possibility that he will find no faith upon the earth at his second coming. You may take that down from the projection. The delusion that the forces of evil have pulled over on people is that all personal perspectives on divine things are equally valid. You have probably heard people say quite openly that all roads lead to heaven. And if they don't say it that way, they say it when someone dies, well, he's in a better place. Don't you cringe when you hear that? It's such a nice thought, so typical coming from the average nice person. You just don't want to remind them of what Jesus said to Thomas just before his ascension, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. When we base our thinking and our living on such exclusive claims that our Lord and Savior made, it rubs the world the wrong way. Therefore, some Christians try to downplay who Jesus really is. For example, Father Richard Rohr, a Franciscan priest who founded the Center for Action and Contemplation in Albuquerque, New Mexico. In his book, Falling Upward, A Spirituality for the Two Halves of Life, he says interesting things like this. We have four often conflicting versions of the life of Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There is not one clear theology of God, Jesus, or history presented, despite our attempts to pretend that there is. The only consistent pattern that I can find is that God is with us and we are not alone. End quote from Father Richard Rohr. Well, now, that's a true statement. God is with us, and we are not alone. We can agree to that. But if you stop there, it does not require you to humbly confess that we are sinners who need the forgiveness that Jesus came into this world to purchase for us on the cross of Calvary. That conviction is a conviction that the Holy Spirit works in our hearts and our minds. And Jesus affirms that in Luke 17, where he talks about the coming of the kingdom of God, saying that it is not something that can be observed, but that it is in you or in our midst. And thereupon, Jesus adds that when things are like they were in the days of Noah and in the days of Lot, the end will come. People will be going about their everyday lives, eating and drinking, marrying and buying, selling, planning and building. In other words, things will be normal in many respects. Is it not so today? However, we can see that although things seem normal, the breakdown of society continues apace in what were once stable Christian nations like Great Britain, Canada, and the United States. Canadian police forces are alarmed at how the bail system much too easily puts criminals back onto the streets. When I went to London Teachers College way back in the early 60s, we carried a little book around that had songs to sing when there were assemblies, and most of those songs, at least half of them, were the kind of hymns we sing in church. And there was the national anthem, of course, O Canada, with all four verses. The third verse said this, O Canada, beneath thy shining skies, may stalwart sons and gentle maidens rise to keep thee steadfast through the years. What do we see today? 8 teenaged girls swarm, stabbing a 58-year-old homeless person to death on the streets of Toronto. We see this. Young people knock over and damage hundreds of tombstones in the little town of Zurich, Ontario. In the U.S., sensible, strong gun control laws are just not passed, even though there were 338 mass shootings by July the 2nd of this year. In the first week of this year, a 6-year-old took a gun to school and shot his teacher. Everyone seems to agree that a lack of respect for parents and for authority of any kind is at the root of so much of what is wrong with society. And of course, they're right. When people no longer want to accept the authority of God nor respect His word, then all other authority has lost the base upon which it stands. It is undermined and toppled as easily as gravestones attacked by mindless vandals. What are Jesus' followers to do in a world that seems to be going mad? Jesus gives us the parable of the unrighteous judge and the persistent widow. The point there is that the widow kept coming back to demand what was rightfully hers. Now, what is it that is rightfully ours as Jesus' followers? According to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28, we are the inheritors of the world to come. That is what is rightfully ours because of the work that Jesus did for us on the cross of Calvary and by His tremendous resurrection. He has in store for us a world that cannot be shaken. And since we are receiving a world that cannot be shaken, a permanent, stable world, in other words, we should therefore, according to Hebrews 12, worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. Then it goes on to say that entails keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters, show hospitality, remember those who are mistreated, keep the marriage bed pure, keep free from the love of money, and be content with what you have. Such living will require great persistence, and such persistence comes from an awareness that we need the power of the Holy Spirit to enable us to hang in there. The tide of secularization that Alice Bailey promoted, that trend to drift away from God, is ongoing. And it's like a tide of the ocean that will sweep you up and sweep you away unless you keep clinging to God, keep your face to the sun, as was said in the children's message this morning, because this tide of secularization keeps going, and you have probably noticed, for instance, that betting, wagering advertisements are now overtaking most of what's of the commercials that you see on TV. It gets really sickening. The Fifth Estate recently revealed that the opening up of online gambling is going to bring an avalanche of mental health problems, of debt and suicide, and will fundamentally change our culture. That's coming from the CBC, which is not always so much on the side of decency and the side of the things that we Christians espouse. And yet, there it is, clearly revealed how evil, how destructive that is. And furthermore, the increasing use of artificial intelligence strengthens the tendency of people to focus on this present material existence as though that's all that matters. The concept of God's kingdom within you now and of an inheritance that will not be shaken, those are foreign concepts to artificial intelligence. So Jesus asks, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith upon the earth? May he find your faith and my faith. The faith of people in persistent prayer. People praying not for something that is withheld by an unrighteous judge, but holding out for the promise of God our Father, who has already judged his Son, so we may gain that splendid inheritance of a kingdom and a world that cannot be shaken. Let us, friends, remain prayerfully persistent and expectantly faithful. Amen. And we make that our prayer as we sing as our hymn of response, 926 from Lift Up Your Hearts, God of Grace and God of Glory. after the prayer for God's benediction, we sing as our doxology number 946 from Lift Up Your Hearts, verses 1 and 3. Go, my children, with my blessing. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loves us and by his grace gives us eternal encouragement and good hope, may he encourage in our hearts, may he encourage our hearts and strengthen us in every good deed and word. Amen.